ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देव महेश्वरः गुरु साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः Before we get into the next topic, which is Brahma Nirvan, we have to re-look at this verse 237-238. Atha pradhang nasti jagat paratmanah. Atha pradhang nasti jagat paratmanah. Pradhak pratitistu mrusha guna divata. आरोपितस्यास्ति किमर्थवत्तात् अधिष्ठानमाभाति तथा भ्रमेण आरोपितस्यास्ति किमर्थ किमर्थवत् अधिष्ठानम् आभाति तथा प्रमेण देयरफॉर द वर्ल्ड इज नॉट अदर देन द सुप्रीम सेल्फ द सेपरेटनेस ऑफ द वर्ल्ड फ्रॉम द सुप्रीम सेल्फ इज लाइक द सेपरेशन ऑफ द एट्रीब्यूट्स फ्रॉम द सब्सटेंस एंड देयरफॉर इज एन इल्यूजन मीनिंग जस्ट लाइक द एट्रीब्यूट्स ऑफ हीट एंड लाइट कैन नॉट बी सेपरेटेड फ्रॉम द सन द वेटनेस कैन नॉट बी सेपरेटेड फ्रॉम द वॉटर the goldness cannot be separated from the gold, and exactly that way the existence aspect, the conscious aspect, the anand aspect, the anant, the infinity aspect, or whatever, just nitya, shuddha, buddha, mukta, swarup, all these, they cannot be separated from the reality. Therefore, the world is not other than the Supreme Self. So, understand this much, that when they make this statement, the world is not other than the Supreme Self, it should not be taken at face value. Then what are they saying? That in essence, the world is nothing but the reality. So, we are just having this understanding here, that world cannot have an independent existence with respect to a reality, with respect to the pure absolute. It cannot. Wave cannot. the heat and light, they cannot have an independent existence of the sun. They are part and parcel of the sun. Wave cannot have an independent existence from the water. It cannot. But now, when we are giving these examples, we are making one mistake. And that is of our attention. Where is our attention? Thoda sa pani dena garam wala. Our attention is on the wave. Our attention is on heat and light. Our attention is on the ornament. This is the world. This is the world. Essence is the substratum. See? Then where is the world? Where is the world as you know it at this moment? It is a vivarta. It is a superimposition on the reality. from the reality's point of view, it does not see any differences. You understand? So here it is told, therefore, the world is not other than the... Thank you. Thank you. World is not other than the Supreme Self. The separateness of the world from the Supreme Self is like the separateness of the attributes from the substance. So, even though we are using the word way, we are using the word ornament, even though we are using the word heat and light, they don't have an independent existence free of the substratum. Understand this world also in that manner. See, the grace of the teacher here is, the compassion we can say, of the Upanishads and the teacher like Adi Shankaracharya or Jnaneshwar Maharaj, is they are trying so hard that you must recognize that recognize this. So many times they are repeating with such systematic unfoldment, they are presenting it to us. And what they are they want, just by reading, by being available to this, by trusting that what they are telling, by believing that what they are telling must be good for me. When you give importance to what they are saying, that the world is not other than the reality, in essence, see, automatically your attention will be on the reality, if not 24 hours, but at least 5 minutes out of 24 hours, then 10 minutes out of 24 hours. That's there, that's all. It only requires one, that's it. Once only it requires. One moment. Chair hai, agar upar baitha hai to. Only one, just like we go back, get absorbed in sleep again and again every day. In reality, you don't have to get absorbed every day again and again. Only once. And once we get in, what this verse is saying, it will become our direct experience-less experience. It will not become our direct experience. It will be direct experience-less experience. Because if you say direct experience, then you are experiencing something directly. There's something, a chocolate has gone into your mouth, now you are having direct experience. It is still coming from outside, going in. Here there is nothing to go in, nothing to experience. Because what will it be? That the Jagat, the world that is available, it is nothing but that one Brahman. One, the moment it clicks, that's all. And therefore, Bhrantasya yadyat bhramata pratitam. Bhrantasya yadyat bhramata pratitam. Brahmaiva tattad rajatam hi shuktihi.
Brahmaiva tattad.
Idantaya Brahma Sadaiva Rupyate. Tvaropitam Brahmani Nama Matram. Can the superimposed be real at all? Can the waxing and waning of the moon be real? Can the sunrise and sunset be real? Can the mirage be real? Can the rope, snake on the rope be real? Can the ghost on the post be real? These are the different examples that are taken in the Upanishads and by various masters to hone in the point that recognize, is this real? So at a relative level, it is real. But the moment you understand sun does not rise, sun does not set, the relative, which is nothing but an illusion, a superimposition on the sun, we continue to use that language, but in our heart of hearts, we know sun does not rise, sun does not set. Sun is fixed in one place. The blueness of the sky is a superimposition. Sky is colorless. You go to look for it, you will not find any blue color. Exactly the same way. Here it says, can the superimposed be real at all? He's questioning us. Like, think. Here we are coming to unlearn what we have learned since childhood and many lifetimes. When you come to the scriptures, you are coming to unlearn, and then, kya ho gaya?
I go back.
What happened?
No, cold.
Close the window. Close the window. Or put the curtain behind your back. Just turn it around. Slowly. Ho gaya, bas ho gaya. Titiksha. Meditator. You need titiksha. A little bit breeze is disturbing. Can the superimposed be real at all? In fact, it is the substratum that is appearing different due to delusion. All that is appearing for the ignorant under the spell of incomplete knowledge is Brahman indeed, just like the appearance of the silver through delusion is the mother of the pearl. All that is recognized as this is Brahman indeed, and the superimposed world is only for namesake. Ignorant call the Brahman as the world through the illusion of incomplete knowledge. Bhranta se yadyat brahmata pratitam. Because of the superimposition, bhranti is superimposition, is illusion. And because of that, yadyat brahmata pratitam. Then therefore you are seeing the ephemeralism nature of the world. Brahmaiva tad rajatam hi shuktihi. Now then the example is taken that brahmaiva tad. Now, the rajatam hi shuktihi, just like the silver is superimposed on the mother of pearl, on a seep, same way the world is superimposed on the Brahman. So, from far away you see a shining object on the beach, children run, adults also run, thinking, there is a piece of silver, there is something expensive object there. But when they go there, they are very disappointed because there is no silver for them to take and sell. Exactly the same way. When we start looking into the essence of the world, we are running after it. Running after the name and form, you were disappointed there. Here also there is disappointment when you are running after the world. Then what we have to do? We have to develop the eye of discrimination. Idantaya brahma sadaiva rupyate. It is the idantaya. Idam means this. Everything we call as this. This world, this space, this air, this fire, everything that is... Purnam idam. Purnam idam. So there also idam comes. So this idam is this. Whatever you... how do you talk about this? By different names, isn't it? Here also so many people are there. Everyone has a different name. I cannot call everyone, hey... I. reality, reality, reality. Brahman, Brahman, Brahman. Mahatmas do that. They say Mahatma, bolo Mahatma ji, ha Devi bolo, Prabhu bolo. And we must put that into our in our language, because we are trying to see. Right now we don't have the vision to see, but when you call someone a Mahatma, when you call someone, give someone a respect, then you cannot abuse that person. Then you cannot have ill feeling towards that person. Then you cannot manipulate that person. So, idantaya brahma sadaiva rupyate. So, all what is idam? All thatness or thisness. It is nothing but Brahman. Brahma sadaiva. It has never got separated from Brahman. It has got here when we say, see, space, air, fire, water, earth. These are the five elements, isn't it? You know, the world is made up of these five elements. But do you see this sofa? Oh, sofa. Do you see space, air, fire, water, earth here? This glass, do you see space, air, fire, water, earth here? That wooden chest of drawers, do you see space, air, fire, water, earth there? This wall, space, air, fire, water, earth? No. You are not seeing it. But can it be without it? This is our problem. This is our problem. It is not a problem of the world. It is our problem because our vision is very, very constricted. It is very, very limited. See, this cat can see what we cannot see. It can hear, its ability to hear is much more than our ears. We can only hear a certain frequency. They can hear more frequency. So anywhere in some bush from far away, she can know some kuch 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 kuch, crack, she'll run there. So how do we increase our spectrum of vision, our spectrum of hearing, our spectrum of senses, or even how can we expand the spectrum of our mind? For that, you have to think of something higher. This is only at the relative level I'm talking about. That in relative, just like we are not able to see space, air, fire, water, these five elements in this glass or in this camera, this is the error here is not in the world. The error here is in your conviction that you are this body. You are not accepting yourself as the conscious principle. Because once you accept it, your whole life will have a different turn. On account of body, all the relationships are there. On account of body, all the security is there. On account of body, we are seeking immortality or liberation so that we don't want to die, we don't want to be reborn. Isn't it? On account of body, everything is going on. Disease, health, comforts, likes, dislikes. It's all for us, for this body. And as long as because we are convinced that we are the body, that is the problem. That's the issue. That's the error. That's the virus that has gone into our mind. So here the teacher is saying, come to this realization that nothing in this world can be other than Brahman. It cannot exist independent to Brahman. Idantaya brahma sadaiva rupyate tvaropitam brahmani nama matram. Then what is the superimposition? Only name and form. So the entire world is merely a superimposition on the reality. Wave is nothing but a name and form which has been superimposed on water. An ornament by whatever name is nothing but a name and form superimposed on gold. Because you are touching gold, you are feeling gold, you are seeing gold. If you lick, you are tasting gold. But you are calling it an ornament. Exactly the same way. In this world, move around with this disposition that you are interacting with the reality alone. That you are not interacting. If I say interacting, there is someone else I am interacting with. That you are moving, you are in reality. Where, just like wherever I go, I can go only in space. I cannot go outside space. Exactly the same way. I am wherever I am, there the reality is. I cannot go outside the reality. This world also cannot go outside the reality. It is part and parcel of this Brahman. In fact, Brahman alone is expressing in the essence, as the essence of the entire. That is what is called Asti Bhati Priya Nama Roop. So that Brahman is Asti Bhati Priya, Sat Chit Anand. And what is the world? Name and form. Asti Bhati Priya, they don't change. But names and forms keep changing. And this name and form has been superimposed on the reality. So the superimposed world is only for namesake. And ignorant call the Brahman as the world through the delusion of incomplete knowledge. So here Swamiji is bringing in Jnaneshwar Maharaj. So Jnaneshwar Maharaj says incomplete knowledge. He doesn't say mithya. He doesn't say illusion. He says incomplete knowledge. So incomplete knowledge about what? Incomplete knowledge about your own self. Incomplete knowledge about your own self. So with this, a transformation in our vision of the world can come about only when we understand first. At least appreciate. Conviction will come later. First appreciate. Allow. And that's what Swamiji says. He told me, come to the course empty, go from the course empty. 2 years you study. So you also come empty to the class, listen as a nobody for the 1.5 hours, and then go away empty again. Then reformatting will happen. Then reformatting will happen. We have to allow, the clay has to allow itself to be kneaded, to become soft by the clay maker. And then he can mold it into whatever. So we have to allow the scriptures to need us. This is kneading of our mind. Daba raha hai, yahan se daba raha hai, wahan se daba raha hai. It's pressing from all different angles. Anywhere you look, he's a Brahman. Ait tere ki. And initially, when these, just like when you are kneading the soil, mud, to make it soft so that you can make something out of it useful. Initially, if the mud says, oh, this is very painful, don't make me wet, and you are slapping me, you are stomping on me, you are pressing me. That pain is there initially. As long as you are the mud. As long as you are the, you are thinking you are someone. So, we have to allow the scriptures. This mind is thinking that it is somebody. This mind is thinking it has an identity. You are not thinking, mind is thinking. This basic error that I am the mind, this has to. But in the previous verse, what did it say? Mind is also nothing but the world. So it is also Brahman. So nothing can be outside Brahman. So thoughts are also Brahman. Having no thoughts also is Brahman. Good thoughts, bad thoughts also is Brahman, in essence. So Brahman is expressing through gods also, and Brahman is expressing through the asuras, the evil people also. It is equally available everywhere. It cannot say, Brahman doesn't say, water doesn't say, I don't want to go in that wave. It will go in every wave. Brahman also doesn't have any choice. Why no choice? Because there is nothing else other than it. There is nothing else other than it. What happens if you keep contemplating on this? Vairagya will come. Yeah, sab kuch hai, yet I am seeing forms and I am living for forms and I am identified with forms and I am pursuing forms and then security for it and then... So, you want to see reality, but our mind's obsession with name and form doesn't allow us to see the... And who wants to see reality? The mind only. Self doesn't have to see anything. So on one hand, mind has understood, it is wanting to look. On the other hand, it cannot let go of names and forms. So what happens? Frustration builds up. Heat builds up. It's a conundrum, you know. There's no solution for it out there. Then vairagya happens. And once vairagya happens, then we go inwards. Who knows? Who is coming to this conclusion? I am. Who is this I? Come back. You will not turn inwards until and unless vairagya is not there. Little bit vairagya. Some appreciation that this world is not what it seems, that must be there. Only then you will turn inwards. Otherwise you will not. Otherwise, what's the reason? Our reason is only one, tiredness. Chalo, the mind turns inwards and goes to sleep every night. And it turns inwards when it's lighting the lamp. So maybe. There also it is looking out at the lamp. While lighting the lamp, does the mind say, yeah, I am lighting the lamp outside, but actually this, the effulgence is my nature. Have you ever thought that way? Or that or lighting lamp also is in a hurry, because train you are missing. Chus! Fatafat! Garbatti lagaye. And that makes you feel good. No doubt it makes you feel good. But we have got addicted to that activity. We have not become subjective. It's still on the periphery. It's still on the circumference. We need to go in. Waves are only on the circumference. World is only on the circumference of the Brahman, if you want to say it that way. Or form of an ornament, where is it? It's only on the outside of the solid gold, isn't it? You can't see form inside. It's only outside. So we have to go in. Now once we have understood that the world is Brahman, we saw before, Atma is nothing but Brahman. That it is the knowable principle in the... And here, now it has been told that Brahman and Jagat are essentially Brahman only. It is nothing else called the world. Now then the question naturally will come, what is Brahman? You are talking about this X factor, this abstract, this unknowable. Before you said knowable, now you are saying unknowable. Why? Because intellect cannot come to know it. What is this? Is there something like it? Yes, there is something. It is all that there is. And what is it? Brahma Nirupan, what Brahman is, the pointers. Atha param Brahma sadadvitiyam. Param Brahma sadadvitiyam. Vishuddha vijnana ghanam niranjanam. Shuddha vijnana ghanam niranjanam. Prashantamadhyantavihinamakriyam. Prashantamadhyantavihinamakriyam. Nirantaranandarasas. Rasaswarupam, tarandarasaswarupam, nirastamaya kruta sarva bhedam, nirastamaya kruta sarva me bhedam, nityam sukham nishkalama prameyam, nityam sukham nishkalama prameyam, arupam avyaktam anakhyam avyayam, Akhyam avyayam jyoti swayam kinchididam chakasti. So here in these two verses, 20 points are given. Pointers. You read one book, Pointers by Nisargadatta Maharaj. Pointers of Nisargadatta Maharaj. See if you can get it in online or Theosophical Society. One of the best books, about 10-15 chapters are there, just 2-3-4 pages. But every pointer, just like here also, we are doing the same thing. That from five koshas, we are coming back to the changeless principle. From the elements, we are coming back to the changeless principle. From the world, we are coming back to the changeless principle. Everything is coming back to the same one. There also is the same. But there it is even more succinct. So here, what are the... These are 20 meditations. You can practice each one of them independently. What should I meditate on? What should I think about? What should I contemplate? Because you are not ready to look at yourself. So here, Atah, therefore, Parabrahma Sadat Sat Advitiyam. So, therefore, the Supreme Brahman is existence, non-dual, pure mass of consciousness, without any impurity, absolute peace, without beginning and end, unactive and ever of the nature of bliss. So what is it? It is existence. Existence, what is that? That which is ever, which is free of birth, growth, disease, decay and death. That is ever existing. Existence never undergoes any change. Then next one is, it is non-dual. Again, there is this Brahman, we are talking about Brahman. Why it is, there is nothing for it to experience and therefore non-dual. There is nothing, there can, because it is the absolute reality, there is nothing else possible which is independent of this reality. And therefore it is non-dual. Pure, Vishuddha is ever pure, extremely pure. What is the impurity that makes the consciousness seem corrupted? It is the thoughts or the vasanas or the subconscious impressions, antahkaran mainly. So antahkaran needs to be wiped out, clean slate, no fog on the mirror of the mind, clear. What is the fog? Each particle of the fog is the vasanas or the subconscious impression. They need to be, they do not exist from Brahman's point of view. So we as individual or as a teacher and student right now, we are talking with in a language. I'm speaking words, you are listening to words. What did Swamiji say? Remain empty. But what are we doing? We are filling up. There is no straight answer for this. So you have to listen also, and yet you don't have to listen. Then what has to be done? Question is, we are so addicted to doing something. So what should be your disposition? And what will happen to this now? Huh? Don't take the ownership. Just watch information coming in and next information coming in, or coming and going, wherever. Where is it coming? It's coming into the mind. Where is it going? I don't know. I have to find out. But I didn't put it in. Did you put it in? You don't put it in, you don't put it out. Where does it go? Every thought is coming in into my mind. After that, where does it go? It can go two places. Which are those two places I'm indicating? Tell.
Subconscious or forgetful.
Subconscious or?
Subconscious is impressions. That's attachment. Or you just ignore it.
Good. Not ignore means? Witness it. Two places. Either it will go in as memory, data, your hard disk is getting full, or if you are a witness, if you have not taken ownership of it, if you have not become a listener, while the words are coming, then it will come, do whatever it has to do in that moment, and then move on. It cannot corrupt the watcher, the witness. It cannot corrupt. But when we say, no, I have to understand, oh, this was fantastic, this was very good, what wonderful verses Shankaracharya has written. We say all this. Let the mind say. You remain. Pure. Then what is the word? Vijnana ghanam. It is homogeneous mass of knowledge. Our knowledge is, this is a camera, this is a table, this is glass of water, this is this person, this is that person. Everything we, whatever we experience or we have see, hear, touch, feel, taste, think, ideate, we need something else to interact with in order to make it our knowledge. What is this? Vijnana ghanam. Ghanam means homogeneous. Thus thus ke bhara hua hai. There is no space for ignorance in it. It is fully stuffed with consciousness. And therefore, the knowledge here is not indirect knowledge. It is of the nature of knowledge. Take another way, and therefore it is, the another word for it is self-knowing. It is self-knowing. It doesn't need words. It doesn't need anything in order to know itself. It doesn't need anything else to know itself. Vijnana ghanam. That is Brahman. So, it can never fall down from that status of all-knowing principle. Nachiketa says in Kathopanishad, O Lord of Death, what is that by knowing which? Nothing else remains to be known. This is what it is. This Brahman. Then next word is Niranjanam. Niranjanam is, Anjan means collyrium. Collyrium is the kajal. Niranjanam. Free of all dirt. Free of all dirt. Means free of all impurity. That which is impurity. Impurity can come only where there is duality. Impurity can come only where there is duality. So where is it coming at this moment? In the mind. Because mind is an expression of duality. Without duality, mind cannot function. And we have told it many, we have discussed it, amritti idamritti, isn't it? The interaction. So unless these two, and then they come to form the triputi, without these two, the mind cannot, if I is not there, mind cannot function. If that is not there, mind cannot function. Idam is not there, mind cannot function. In this homogeneous mass of knowledge, there is no duality ever possible. There is no impurity ever possible. There is no sense of otherness ever possible. There is no difference, sense of difference, because it is all encompassing. So there is no otherness. If there is no otherness, there is no duality. And therefore, prashantam. These three words are there: shanti, ashanti, shanti, and prashanti. Satya Sai Baba has made prashanti nilam. So ashanti means restlessness, no peace. Shanti means peace, and prashanti means transcendental peace, which does not come and go. So when our experience is in the deep sleep, there is peace, there is happiness, there is joy. Why? Because the turmoil of the world is not disturbing us now. The projects are not disturbing. The responsibilities, duties, nothing is disturbing. You are dead to the world. Therefore, you are at peace in sleep. But that is also temporary, because next day you are again going to get up. But this prashanti is transcendental. It is independent. Therefore, it is bliss. It is not just, it is that peace. What is that word? The peace that passeth. I'm making your own. Oh, okay. No, that is the next one. Peace that passeth all duality. That is this transcendental peace. Prashanti. And that is that Brahman. Prashanti, prashantam, adi antavihinam. Adi adyantavihinam, but adi antavihinam. Adi means beginningless. Anta, end. So, vihinam, free of, independent of beginning and end. That which is all encompassing, that which is ever pure, that which is ever peaceful, that which is in which there is no sense of difference and no sense of otherness, which is complete at all the time. In fact, even time is not there. Such one cannot have a beginning and an end. Beginning and an end, beginning and end is always of the form. The substratum does not have a beginning and end. Water does not have beginning and end. Wave has a beginning and end, but wave is a superimposition on the water. Ornament has a beginning and end. Gold doesn't have a beginning and end. From the example point of view, see? So in this way, adi antavihinam akriyam, and therefore there is no activity in it. It is, Brahman is free of all activity. Activity means movement. Movement is only where there is duality. Only where there is sense of otherness, there is someone else other than you. To perceive, to hear, to smell, to taste, to think, to imagine, to travel, whatever, to breathe. If I don't breathe the air, I will die. Something else by which you are holding on to your identity. Because you have forgotten your original identity. So what is this Brahman? this Brahman is akriyam. There is no movement or activity possible, because activity requires movement, and movement can be only between two, from A to B. They have to be separate from, B has to be separate from A. But here in this homogeneous, all-pervading Brahman, there it is all that there is. Where it will go? There is nowhere for it to go. So no activity. Nirantar Ananda Swarupam. It is of the Swarupam. Its nature is Nirantar Ananda. Continuous bliss. Continuous bliss. Unbroken bliss. Taila Dharavat. Like the oil. No drops, no breaks. Continuously it's flowing. And because of the previous points, because of no sense of all these points that we saw, non-dual, pure, mass of consciousness without any impurity, absolute peace, without beginning and end, unactive, and therefore, always nirantara ananda. When you are free of all duality, and you are free of all thoughts of unity also. Brahman doesn't think I am Brahman. Brahman does not think that I am Brahman. If you ask Brahman, who are you? You are asking. Brahman cannot answer. Because he is all that there is. There is no answer. Therefore, Ramana Maharishi used to stay silent. Can't answer. Therefore, Dakshinamurti Stotram, Maunam Vyakhyat. Because what can you talk about it? So here it says, and therefore this Anand is not of any particular expression. It is the Anand of your essential nature. It is not even, it is not corrupted by silence, or it is not enhanced by silence, nor is it corrupted by speech or thoughts. It is that silence which is beyond all understanding. Yeah, the word that I was using, looking for, I said, peace that passeth all duality, peace that passeth all understanding. That is the statement. So it is that bliss which is not, it is uncaused bliss. This bliss is uncaused. Not because of I am happy. No. Happiness is its nature. Bliss is its nature. Our experience. Oh, you got Hindi song as a tune. Na 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 na. So it is uncaused. Our bliss or our happiness is always because of something. It's cause and effect here. Wherever there is name and form, wherever there is sense of otherness, there is cause and effect. But in Brahman, the Anand, the bliss, Nirantaram, continuous, unabated, homogeneous, uncaused Anand, that is its nature. Continuing, Nirasta Maya Kruto Sarva Vedam Nityam Sukham Nishkalama Prameyam Arupam Avyaktam Anakhyam Avyayam Jyotis Swayam Kinchidadam Chakasti. It is free from the limitations of Maya and its effects, eternal, blissful, without parts, not an object of knowledge for senses, etc. It is some formless, unmanifest, without name, without loss, self-effulgent reality that is shining forth. So, nirasta maya krita sarva bhedam. It is free from the limitations of maya and its effects. What is maya? It is non-apprehension. Non-apprehension of reality. What is maya? That which is not is maya. What is maya? Ignorance is maya. What is maya? Incomplete knowledge is maya. Different ways you can put it. What is maya? That which covers the substratum, that is, that which is superimposed on the substratum is maya. That which does not allow you to see a thing as it is maya. What is maya? That which exists in its own absence is maya. Ornament, the name and form of the ornament, is existing in its own absence. What is there? Gold. Different ways of putting it. Who is Brahman? Who is free of this maya? It is not how should I say? And okay, one more thing before we come to Brahman. How do we know there is maya? How do we know there is ignorance? How do we know there is illusion? How do we know there is non-apprehension? We know there is non-apprehension only because there is projection. How do we know cause? You cannot come to know cause. Only when you know the effect, you say, where did she come from? Oh, she's daughter of her parents. Only through effect we determine the cause. So what is maya? Non-apprehension. Only because there is projection. Misapprehension is projection. Multiplicity. Maya is avyakta. Maya is anadi. But what is its effect? This whole world. The multiplicity. So if you are taking this maya and its effect, the whole world, the name and form, only the name and form, not the essence. Therefore it is called vivarta. Vivarta is superimposition. The world is only a superimposition. So what can maya produce? Illusion. Only the illusion of superimposition. It cannot produce Brahman. It can only bring about the illusion of superimposition. See? Brahman is independent of this also. So, Brahman is free from cause and effect. So, when in Virat Roop, Krishna Bhagwan shows Arjuna, what is Arjuna's problem? I don't want to kill my relatives, I don't want to kill my gurus, I don't want to kill my cousins, I don't want to go to hell, I don't want to... complaining, crying baby. And what did Lord say? In 11th chapter, he shows him the Virat Roop. What does he see? That whatever is he is afraid of, that has already happened. That has already happened. It begins that way. And as the magnanimity of the Virat Roop gets presented to Arjuna, he sees even the past, present, future, they are just cosmic soup. It's everything is going on at the same time. And he gets overwhelmed with that vision. And he says, please show me your normal form. I can't handle this. My mind is reeling. I know it is very something great that you are showing to me, but my mind is not able to handle it. He's getting overwhelmed. So why did I give this example? So that you can all cause and effect is from individual point, from mind point of view. Forget individual, mind point of view. Where there is duality, there is cause and effect. But Brahman is independent of cause and effect because it's the all-inclusive principle. In fact, that statement also is a bit short. It has a shortcoming because then there is something to include. But that is only in language we can explain. We can say water is all-inclusive principle of all the waves and all the oceans. Because we haven't got there yet, so we have to speak exactly that way. Brahman is inclusive of micro and macro, cause and effect. It is, next word is nityam. It is eternal. Eternal is that which has never ceased to exist. That is eternal. It is a continuous existence. That which is free of big, it has never been created, it has never died, therefore it is eternal. It has not never gone out of existence. That is eternal. Sukham, and because it is of the nature of nitya, nitya vastu. That, what is nitya vastu? Another way, nitya vastu is that which is all the time available. It never goes out of unavailability. You are available to me now, I can speak. After some time you will go away. Whom will I speak to? Then what do? Then I hear, put a TV on. See? Then I put the food in, some interaction. So here he says, it is eternal, sukham, blissful. Blissful, we saw this, nirantara ananda swarupam. The same thing is told here, that it is of the nature of bliss because it is ever and therefore blissful. Next one is nishkalam aprameyam. Nishkalam aprameyam. So what does that nishkalam means? Kala is the 16 kalas of the moon, waxing and waning of the moon. So where there is no waxing and waning, that is Brahman. That which never becomes less or more, that is Brahman. That which is ever complete, that is Brahman. That on which nothing can be superimposed, nishkala, that is Brahman. On moon, you can superimpose the 16 kalas. On woman, mother, daughter, sister can be superimposed, isn't it? On Brahman, Brahman is that nothing can be superimposed because it is all there. There is, you need someone else to superimpose. No, keep taking it subjectively. You need someone else other than Brahman to superimpose on Brahman, but other than Brahman, nothing is. So who will superimpose? A different angle of looking at it. Not an object of knowledge. Brahman is not an, what is the word here? Aprameyam. There is one knowledge which is we are using right now. One is indicative knowledge and one is implied knowledge. One is that you can, we are talking here, we are indicating something through thoughts, through words. Like I say, she is a good person. These words are, what are you saying? This form, Renuka. What is it telling? This person is a good person. Can you see the goodness? It's a quality. You're not seeing the quality yet. So What is it? The words are saying it is good, but the goodness is implied. Goodness is implied. So here, when we are talking about the various, these 20 points, all of them are implied. So when it says here, it is not an object of knowledge. All knowledge that we are having right now is by way of thoughts. What it is implying, there our attention must be. And where should it be? It on that principle which is the substratum of even these thought knowledge, even of this thought knowledge. That this thought knowledge cannot come independent of that substratum. Understand? Our problem is we have become a slave of thought knowledge. We have become a slave of thought knowledge. Without thinking, we cannot communicate. Without thinking, we feel we are going crazy. Thank you. And if someone is quiet for some time and they don't reply to your question or your whatever, listen. अपने आप को क्या समझ रहा है? हैं? Something wrong? Because we can't stop thinking. That person is happy. Not speaking. Not out of depression, but he's not speaking because that is another way of being. Anyway, so not an object of knowledge here. Understand this. What is that word? Aprapya manasasah. What is the previous before that? Yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasasah. So it is not a subject that you can talk about, yet we are talking right now. So while talking, we have to understand what is the implied meaning of these words. Don't get lost in the words. Then aprapya manasasah, that it cannot be comprehended, embraced, conceptualized, verbalized by the mind. It is the substratum of all this. All these concepts, verbal comprehension, it is all limited. Why it is limited? Because it is expressing through a conditioning called mind. Understand? And body, breath, mind, intellect, all these are waking, dream, deep sleep, all these are effects of Maya, of incomplete knowledge, of ignorance. Therefore, how can they come to know the substratum? Because they themselves are limited, expressing through a limited conditioning called mind or intellect. And therefore, we have to keep coming to the implied meaning, shifting our attention to, what it is implying, what is it, what is that essence that it is talking about? It is talking about Brahman. The word Brahman is not, it is implying some principle. It is implying some principle which is abundantly available all the time. It has never gone out of existence. And it is even here right now, even while we are speaking and we are listening. And we are seeing, we are hearing, we are touching, we are feeling, even right now. So it is not that you have to come to know it posthumously. No, you have to know, you can be it right here and now, in spite of everything that is going on. So it is not an object of knowledge for senses, and I just already explained this. Then, arupam avyaktam anakhya avyayam. So arupa, It is formless. Brahman is formless. It may be supporting all the forms, but from its point of view, there is no form because it is a center without a circumference. It is a center without circumference, without form. It's everywhere equally available. Purnamada, Purnamidam, Purnat, Purnamudachyate. Even if so much water is evaporating over in the oceans don't become less. So many rivers are being added into the waters, it doesn't break, it doesn't become become a flood. It ever remains the same. But here we are talking about rivers coming in and water evaporating. So imagine now if you put the same thing, that out of Brahman, the creation is coming out. You cannot, you can only imagine, isn't it? It is formless, unmanifest. What is the word? Avyakta, unmanifest. That which is the substratum, that which is the cause of all causes, has to be unmanifest. A name and form cannot be can be a cause of everything. It cannot be. Without name, whom will it call? Whom will it call? Or who will call it? Even the word Brahman, this comes in our Amrit Anubhav. Remember that you even to call this Paramatma, Satchidanand, is also an abuse to that reality. Literally, Jnaneshwar Maharaj says like this, it's a slap, it's an abuse. Sat is being, the word Sat is not used to indicate the reality. Sat is, the word Sat is used to counteract Asat. Existence is, word is used that it is ever existing so that our mind doesn't go into non-existence. The word consciousness, full chaitanya ghana, or it's of the nature of knowledge, so that our attention does not go on unconsciousness. And it is called anand, so that our attention doesn't go to dukkham, to the miseries. Therefore, these words are used. But Brahman cannot be called Brahman also. You are calling because you are you feel you are incomplete, therefore you are calling. Because of incomplete knowledge, you are calling it Brahman. But look at it from Brahman's point of view. It is all that there is. Can it call? Is there anyone who can call it? No. Then what? Next one? Avyayam, without loss. Avyaya is that which can never become less, which is always complete. Purnamada, Purnamada. Abhi pehle bataya tha. And therefore, with all these, now the second last point, or last point, Jyoti Swayam, it is self-effulgent. Self-effulgent means there is nothing in this creation, name and form, nothing in this creation which can illuminate Brahman, which can know Brahman, which can, oh, Brahman is this, cannot. Oh, Brahman is the word Brahman, no, that also, no, because Brahman word also ends. The word Brahman also ends. It began with ba, ends with na. You can't even say that. Swayam Jyotihi, it is self-effulgent, means it is self-knowing, means it is self-illuminating. It is that illuminating principle in which in the light of which you can come to know all the concepts, all the thoughts, all the emotions, the breath, the body, the whole world. But nothing that it is illuminating can illuminate the Brahman. It is that. And where? Everywhere, not in just inside of you. See, the consciousness inside of you, which is expressing as life, it is called Atma. This Atma at the totality level is called as Brahman. So we are the micro. At the macro level, the same consciousness at the macro level is called as Brahman. So it is equally present everywhere all the time. And nothing in this, what we call as our creation, has the capacity, ability, acumen to illuminate it. And therefore it is self-illumining, Swayam Jyotihi. Swayam Jyotihi, Kinchid Idam Chakasti, and this way, this is the way Brahman is. Continuing, Nyatrugneya Jnana Shunyam,
Anantam Nirvikalpakam,
Kevala Khanda Chinmatram, Param Tattvam Vidurbudhaha. Wise experience this supreme reality as free from the trio of knower, knowledge and known, therefore infinite, without modifications, without any kind of differences, and unbroken consciousness. So here, after having given us the 20 pointers to know the Brahman, to meditate upon Brahman, that, see, then you will say, why should I meditate if it cannot be known, it cannot be known by the mind? This is one error that comes, isn't it? Oh, if I cannot come to know the sleep, then why you go to sleep? I can ask the same question. If you don't know, sleep is a state of ignorance. That's why I don't know. As if you are intelligent right now. Even now you are ignorant. Only after waking up you come to know you have gone to sleep, isn't it? But you are surrendering to an unknown, which is called sleep. Here, we are surrendering to avyaya, which cannot be known. Or avyakta, unmanifest. It is the infinite unmanifest. It cannot be known. To him you have to surrender. At least nobody has given this type of commentary about sleep. Has anyone? They say sleep is blissful, but they say it is ignorantly you are blissful there. Here we are talking about that reality which is ever present, all the 20 points. So it's positive. And you have what it takes. What does it take? It requires you to surrender. So if you can surrender to an unknown called deep ignorance in deep sleep, why can't you surrender to a known which is ever present, which has never abandoned you, which doesn't come and go, which is all-knowing, which is ever blissful, which is free of birth and death? Logic says yes, but we don't do it because of our
body identification.
No, that is common, but here we more, because in our intellect this U-turn is not happening, or this attention is not going there, because for us the world of names and forms is more real than the Brahman. That is why it is not happening. We are happy to hear about Brahman. We are happy to contemplate on Brahman 5 minutes a day, 10 minutes a day. But if Brahman takes more time of mine, if meditation takes more time of mine and it starts creating a problem and it is pulling me in, and that is becoming a problem in my profession, that is becoming a problem in my carrying out my responsibilities and duties, the first casualty will be Brahman. Right or not? Be truthful. Because we are not convinced that it is a worthy goal to pursue. For us, names and forms are still very real. We are absolutely convinced about it. And therefore, little bit of pull comes, we sabotage it. Absorption comes, we sabotage it, and we come back out. Jada spiritual nahi. No, I have to keep. Life should be in balance. This is how we talk to ourselves. Life should be in balance. Who are you fooling? Yourself. See? So wise experience this supreme reality as free from the tree of nor known knowledge. So here, when we have gone through these two verses and come to completely, correctly ascertain. Now if you look at this language, you cannot tie down Brahman is this or that. You cannot say. If you take all the 20 qualities, you cannot say anything. You can only say, the only thing that is told is, it is a homogeneous mass of bliss, that it is self-effulgent, but everything else is in a negative way, that it is not this, it is not that, it is not this, that it is the all-inclusive principle, nothing is outside of it, it is without birth, without, isn't it? Niranjan, it is without any impurity. So, once we have gone through all that, then the wise, what they come to know, that every thought that is appearing in their mind is because of this triad. Knower, known, knowing. Experiencer, experienced, experiencing. Subject, object, and instrument of knowledge. So if you are seeing, seer, seen, and the eyes are the instrument. Hearer, heard, the eye takes the position of hearer. Sound becomes the heard and ear becomes the instrument. Similarly, when we are on the seat of meditation, every thought that appears is because of the interaction of these three things. And who are wise? Everything, all these 20 qualities, how have we come to know? Through words. These words cannot be without the triad. And what have the wise come to understand? That what these words are talking about, the implied meaning is that it is beyond the triad, it is beyond the thoughts, it is that which is even the substratum of the thoughts. Thoughts cannot appear outside that Brahman. So here it is written, wise experience the supreme reality as free from the tree of knower, knowledge and known. So only an indication is given here that the wise know it. But they know it as free from the thoughts, free from imagination, free from conviction, free from conceptualization. Therefore, infinite without modifications, without any kind of differences, and unbroken conscious, infinite without modifications, that no modification is possible in this absolute reality which we are calling here as Brahman. No modification, no change is possible. Where is change possible? in the world. In the Jagat, change is possible. Jagat means change. It's not that change is possible. Jagat means change. World means change. They are not just like sun is heat and light, inseparable. Jagat means change. It is not inseparable. So therefore, all modifications are in the Jagat, and this Brahman, continuously you are flipping. When we are talking negatively, we are looking from here, and then we have to take the position of what could be from Brahman's point of view. There is no change possible. From water's point of view, no waves are possible, because water is not just waves. Water's existence is 14 kilometers deep into the earth, in the depth. You also jump into the waters, go 15, 20 feet, 30 feet, and you look up, you can't see waves. You will see only water. You can't see waves. You can't even hear them. You can't see the going up and down of the water. Nothing. This is only 30 feet. Imagine. So where is the name and form? I have told you before also. Where is it? On the periphery. Only on the circumference. But Brahman is without circumference. But Brahman is without circumference. Waters, we can say, have a circumference because they are surrounded by land here and there. And then we call it a ocean. Right? But Brahman is without any circumference. So where will the world appear? In its own absence. Without any kind of differences. Within the Brahman, there is a Kevala. Kevala means it is one without a second. Then Kevala Akhanda. It is continuous. Chin Matram. Of the nature of consciousness. It is one without a second, homogeneous, continuous mass of knowledge. Chin Matram. Param Tattva, it is transcendental. Transcendent and without any kind of differences and unbroken consciousness. Okay. Param Tattvam. Tattvam is essence. Param is transcendental. Beyond everything. What is beyond everything? Everything that you know. It is beyond that. It is transcendental to that. Meaning that whatever you know cannot even touch it. Cannot even touch it. Vidur Budhaha is the wise people. The wise people know it in this manner. Aheyam Anupadeyam.
Aheyam Anupadeyam.
Manovachamagocharam.
Aprameyamanadhyantam.
Brahma Purnam Mahanmahah. This Brahman neither can be rejected nor can be gained. It is neither the object of mind or speech, unlike anything, without beginning and end, complete in itself and the great effulgence. Again, the points are same points somehow or the other, but an important point, aheyam, it cannot be rejected. No? And anupadeyam, it cannot be gained. You cannot reject, oh, I have forgotten that I am the reality. You are imagining that you are forgotten. You cannot forget it. Oh, in samadhi I realize myself. You cannot realize it. You cannot realize it. Then what do they say? God realization, self realization. They are making a fool of you and making money. Don't go. Don't go for the courses. Why? Because you are already that. You are already that. This is the beauty of Vedanta. The word used there is kara amalavat. This truth, this reality is as available, as much available, just like a amla fruit in your palm. It's available to you. It's yours. This reality is also yours. It's already there. So this Brahman can neither be rejected, aheyam, cannot be gained. So there is no means, no supports, no thinking, no words, no meditation, no japa that can make you gain it. Oh, if I don't do it, I'll lose it. You cannot lose it. Oh, I think I have gone far away. I hope God forgives me. You cannot go far away from it. No, I am a sinner. You cannot do any sin. You have never gone away from it. You cannot go near to it. Why? It is in and through everything. We are not talking about I am. Right now we are just talking about the topic is Brahman. Next chapter, next page, next verse, we'll talk about you. Right now we are talking about Tat. Tvam will come next time, next verse. Brahman is Tat, that infinite. So when we say Brahma, Atma, Aikya, Bodha, so here we are talking about Brahma. Atma we'll talk about next page. And Aikya also will come there only. So here the topic is only, in the previous topic, the topic was how world is nothing but Brahman. Now the topic is Brahman is all that there is. What is the definition of Brahman? What is the quality of Brahman? How do I process it in my mind? That's all you are doing. So don't get lost. Now don't think Brahman is a result of process. No, it is not a result of process. But as long as you are an individual who feels he has got an intellect, he has to think, he has to work it out, he has to logicalize, etc., etc. So we are using all these words, but none of these words, conclusions, can sit with you as an experience. It doesn't create a concept in your mind. When it says it is unborn and undying, yeah, I understood. What did you understand? You understand zilch. You cannot understand. You don't know anything that is unborn and undying. Oh, God. Have you seen God? No. So forget about it then. We nod, we smile, because it's touching a chord. And that chord is, it's talking about, because that Brahman whom we are talking about, he's expressing through you also. At this very moment, so the smile comes. Mano vachama gocharam means it is neither the object of mind or speech. We have already spoken about it. Unlike anything, aprameyam anadi antam brahma purnam mahan mahaha. Without beginning and end, complete in itself, Brahma Purna. It is Purna Vada Purna Midam. Nothing can be removed from it, nothing can be added to it. Adi Antam, beginningless and endless. Mahan Mahaha, greater than the greatest. Mahat Maha. Mahat is great, greatest. Or greater than the greatest, you can say. Mahat Maha. So in this way, recognize this Brahman, and in our next class, we will tell you that this Brahman that you talked about is you only. So first we have to be clear where we are heading in our mind. Mind only. Because as we keep saying so many times, what is that which is creating the distance between you and that infinite? The mind. Because mind works in duality. So it has created a duality between you and yourself. It has created the micro, the individual, and macro, the Brahman. Who? Mind. And it has coined beautiful words also. Atma, Brahman. And he's playing with it. Some people remain playing. They become Shastris, Pandits. Here we have to be subjective. Subjective does not mean remain in the thoughts. Subjective means while mind is thinking, what it is implying, be there, be that. What it is indicating, be that. While it mind is thinking. So in this manner, all this language, all the scriptures are for the mind and not for the Brahman or the Atma. We'll take it. Next topic is inquiry into the great statement and the statement of Tattvamasi. That will be taken and we will contemplate on that in our next class. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om. Sit quietly for a minute or so.